Hello and welcome to the last session of the inaugural conference. This is a panel conversation and something amazing is about to take place. If you just watch, ready, look.
Hey.
You should still be able to hear me, and I should be able to hear you. Is that right? Can everybody hear me? Can you hear, is it working? Can you all can all hear me. Well, you can all hear me because you just sat there and I have a loud voice. So great panel discussion to wrap up today, but we do need your input, those little ideas, the things that are buzzing around your head, the things that haven't yet been answered for you. Now is the time. Please do get them out. If there's stuff that you want to know, please do ask. And at the end, we'll be doing some voting just to try and work out the sort of top things that hopefully you've taken away from iStrategy and that you can take back to your businesses. So it should be a lot of fun. Our esteemed panel each have case studies and examples to discuss. And these, as I said before lunch, we put through the filter of four key words that myself and the team have been picking up from the sessions here and from the tweets and from talking to everybody last night. Now, I am aware that there have been way more than four key words, but there are four panelists, so it did seem to fit quite nicely. Those keywords are advocacy, amplitude, listening, and trust. So let's meet our panel. Big round of applause, please, for Amy Wiglett, Vice President of Marketing for Logo MTV Networks, who will be providing her view on the absolute importance of advocacy. Come take a seat. Daniel Connor, CEO of hybrid agency Struck Accium, will talk to Amplitude. There he is, wandering through in the back there. Keep clapping. Andy Vogul, Vice President of Emerging Media for the LA Times, will be talking about listening. And Alana Brody, Vice President of Social Media at cancerconnect.com, will be talking quite clearly about trust. And what we're going to do is we're going to run through some introductions, we're going to run through people's jobs, what they do, that sort of thing, some very, very quick questions about each of those things, and then really it's over to you. I would like to hear anything and everything you have to ask. So I was wondering if we could start with you, please, Amy, if you could just introduce yourself and give me an outline of your role.
Sure. My name is Amy Wagler, and I'm the VP of Marketing for Logo, which is a channel owned by MTV Networks. It focuses on the gay community. And I oversee all of the marketing, consumer, advertiser-related integrated marketing, and event and sponsorship marketing.
Thank you very much indeed. Daniel?
My name is Daniel Connor. I'm the CEO of Struck Accium. We're a creative agency that specializes in executional strategies, ideation, design on both the graphic and interactive standpoint, as well as development and production.
Thank you very much indeed. Andy?
Andy Vogul. I'm the Vice President of Emerging Media at the Los Angeles Times Media Group. My group oversees everything from the traditional website, which we now consider a legacy product, as well as emerging products in video, social, and mobile.
Thank you very much indeed. Alana?
My name's Alana Brody. I'm Vice President of Social Media for cancerconnect.com, which is a brand new website we launched about 4 months ago. It's a social network for people with cancer, caregivers, loved ones, anyone who has an interest in the disease. And it's probably important that you know my background. I was the Senior Vice President for Strategic Development for the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, which is a national network of leading cancer centers in this country, prior to launching this project.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. So we'll start with you, Amy, if you don't mind. You described Logo as one of the smaller brands at MTV, saying we are challenged to be scrappy, i.e. you work with a limited budget, but in the same landscape as some very powerful media brands. You said social is key. Can you talk us through an example, what you did, where you did it, and how advocacy has worked for you?
Sure. So I said this yesterday, and I really hadn't thought about it until I got here. Just what a... When I think it was the American Express man, the chief marketer of the American Express was talking about just the amount of marketers who are competing for your attention. And Logo is a small digital cable network. We're in 50 million homes. And yet, in order for us to monetize and become successful, I need to drive an enormous amount of viewers to our television networks. My dollars are a tenth of what my sister networks are, and yet I have to monetize and build a network. I also think the stakes are really high. If the gay channel fails, it makes a political statement. And so the stakes are really high. So advocacy and developing a community of Uber fans and online advocates was crucial to our early success. It wasn't enough that you watched the network. You had to tell 10 of your friends. And I don't have the same budgets to reach everywhere that my potential audience is, so I needed my fans to reach them for me. So we employed social marketing from a very early on at Logo, and a lot of what we're doing, I think Logo is considered kind of like the little test ground at MTV Networks. We can play, we have a lot more latitude, we can test things, we can try things out, and if it works, the success is amplified within our organization as well and picked up by some of our bigger networks.
And do you mind if I ask, hands up please if you've heard of RuPaul's Drag Race? RuPaul's Drag Race? There we go. Is that a sort of fairly accurate kind of sample?
You know, there's also something I found that there's people who don't... I was once asked that question in a meeting, and after the meeting I was yelled at for outing people, which is just... And most people who watch RuPaul's Drag Race are straight, by the way. So I
apologize.
So nobody
felt like I was trying to out you. I genuinely wasn't.
But you know, it's RuPaul's Drag Race has tremendous brand awareness. For me, the how I knew we reached a pop culture high for me was the day of our opening on the Ellen DeGeneres show. Ellen plays this game where she asks her guests to say the first thing that comes to their mind. In Ellen Pompeo, the first thing that came to her mind, Ellen DeGeneres said TV show, Ellen Pompeo said RuPaul's Drag Race. And I was really impressed with that. You know, we had such limited budgets, and I was competing at a time where media companies were spending millions and millions to reach these eyeballs. It's Miley Cyrus's favorite show. Queen Latifah calls it her guiltiest pleasure. For me, I name drop those names to show how we've been able to take a little tiny show and a little tiny brand, and yet it feels much bigger than that due to, I would have to say, a genius social media marketing manager who's sitting in the second row with blonde hair. You might want to bother her later. And a really good product.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, we'll get into how that worked in a minute. Andy, listening, it clearly important to something like the LA Times. You also picked up on a point yesterday that social is inherently local, the thing that we were talking about earlier. Can you share some examples of how the LA Times have embraced both of those things?
Sure. We're in an interesting position because 50% of our page view growth over the last year has been local. And we still have a situation where less than 10% of our 500 journalists actually participate in social media. So some of the things that we've done to try and engage the journalists in the community are projects like one we launched a few years ago called Accium, which took the missed connections piece of Craigslist and turned it into a map mashup where we then went back and said, if two people were on the freeway and they talked to each other through their convertible tops, because there's a lot of traffic in LA if you hadn't heard, then they had an opportunity on Craigslist to try and connect, but Craigslist was not as large a megaphone as some people would have liked. So we amplified the megaphone and made it possible for people to reconnect via that on a product we called Accium. We took all the data, we mashed it up onto a map so that people could see the types and demographics of the people that were connecting, and then we took our journalists and we actually had them do follow-up interviews with people to see how it impacted their lives. We've also then launched a number of enterprise reporting projects, one that's gone national where we've gone through 7 years of data in standardized tests in the state of California for the Los Angeles Unified School District, and we've actually rated thousands and thousands of teachers as best or worst. So if your child goes to school and learns underneath this teacher, they're either going to do better in life or worse as a result of having that teacher. Huge outcry, boycott by the teachers union, protests across all the bridge overpasses in LA. And what came out of that were a lot of very genuine human interest stories. So we were able to hook up teachers who had retired who said, boy, I'm really disappointed that I was rated as one of the worst teachers because I never taught to the test. What I taught to were my students. Through using social media and posts on Facebook, we were able to get our journalists, the people who wrote these stories, to interact with some of these teachers who had been rated worst. And as a result of that, their former students now are posting on Facebook saying, boy, Mrs. Malarkey was one of the best teachers I ever had. If it weren't for her, I wouldn't be where I am. And so we've used that as a way to kind of bring the stories around and engage more of our journalists in social media. So it's really been a good organic growth project for us.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Jay. And again, we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Alana, clearly trust absolutely key to the success and value, I think, of CancerConnect.com. You said yesterday that when people are diagnosed with cancer, their doctor will encourage them to be a partner in their care, which I wasn't aware of. How do you become a trusted source for them at that point?
Sure, Adam. Well, you can imagine how frightening it is to be newly diagnosed with cancer. You know, you're going along in your life, and then all, you know, maybe you haven't been feeling well, but you hear this terrible news. Now, all of a sudden, your physician expects you to have, like, a medical degree. You know, they say, here are your treatments, here are your options, maybe you want to try this clinical trial, and you have no idea where to even begin your research. So people typically will go online and Google their disease, which is pretty scary, quite honestly, because anybody can, as you know, can put anything up on the internet. So what we've developed is a community that's backed by a publisher that's a specialty publisher in oncology, OmniHealth Media. The ownership are oncologists. We all have a medical, I don't have a medical background, but I was with a national organization that developed content for people with cancer and also for physicians. So we have a certain credibility factor, and that's why I'm working with this group right now and why we've developed this site. Our site is fully moderated, so anybody who comes into the community is welcomed by a moderator who helps to guide them to relevant conversations. And it's unbelievable to me, really, the kinds of things people will post on this community, things they'd never post on Facebook about their treatments, about their diagnosis. People come into this community looking for someone who's going through exactly what they're going through. And it's a national community, so the likelihood of them finding someone is increased because, you know, there's people from all over the country, really actually around the world, on this community.
Absolutely. Thank you very much indeed. And you managed to, I've left Daniel to end for a very sort of specific point because, of course, you have the easiest question. So, Daniel, Amy, Alana, and Andy, we met up yesterday and we were talking about what we should cover off today. And all three of them said that they wanted to hear something particular from the agency side of things. You talked about amplification and authenticity. So let's start with that easy question. How did you come up with a big idea and make it go viral?
Wow. was that the question I got asked?
That was the question you got.
Interesting. You know, it's just interesting. I mean, you come to these events with some pretty solid thoughts about how the world works, and, you know, as the conversations continues to evolve, I find myself, you know, questioning kind of the own foundations of where it goes and what happens next. But, you know, I do believe, you know, in the spirit of, you know, how do we make things, you know, viral or social or you know, really connect with our audience, right? I mean, the idea of amplification is the idea that it's getting louder, right? It's creating a groundswell. And it falls on a lot of different things, but I think in kind of the position that we take from the agency side, especially our Struck Accium, is that now more than ever, the creative idea is frankly more important, that the details matter, right? That it's about creating an idea, a big idea that doesn't just connect on one channel, but connects through all the various channels. Because what's happening in our perspective is, you know, social media isn't destroying any particular marketplace. I mean, the market is not shrinking by any means. It's simply expanding. There are additional touch points. So to be relevant and to be and to truly connect with your audience, with your customers, with your advocates, you know, you need to have an original thought. There needs to be something there that is provoking, that is witty, that is, you know, from a data standpoint, that challenges the status quo. And creativity, you know, which I think there's always this idea like the big idea in marketing, which I think it's downplayed a lot. You know, creativity is the idea or the stance of doing something that's never been done before. You know, it's about being original. And, you know, everything that we talk about, RuPaul's, you know, drag show, I mean, that's an original idea. It's an original concept that people get excited about, people want to share, want to talk about. Jeff today, you know, talking about the HP business and and how Kodak, you know, what he did with Kodak. I think the reason he was inspiring is because he was a guy that has not only that, was kind of inspiring original thought and also action on upon those thoughts. So I think that in order to really amplify your message, I think you need to understand that the industry is changing, and it's going to require us to all take a little bit, you know, to step out of our comfort zone, to take the risk to do something that, you know, may not be proven, you know, from a risk standpoint. Your risk analyst may not be super excited about it, but you know in your hearts of hearts that it's a great idea, it will resonate, and that you're going to kind of take that chance. And that goes not only from the creative standpoint, but also from the client standpoint. That this is a new frontier in creative, whether you like it or not, it really does matter.
Thank you very much indeed. So now you have a sort of kind of rough idea of everybody, what they do, and their responsibilities and those sorts of things. And I think you can see there are, you know, some incredibly authentic stories up there and some good, solid ideas. What we're going to do now is just talk a little bit about the challenges around that. And I'm going to turn my piece of paper. So, Alana, if we can start with you. You said it began about 4 months ago. Clearly a brilliant and very noble project. But like anything, you have to grow your membership. You know, you have to make it work and all those sorts of things. How are you looking to do that?
Right, thanks. That's a great question. And one of the other themes that we've noticed here, and we talked about actually this morning, is local. And nothing's more local than healthcare. And so we've developed a product as part of this website. So cancerconnect.com, if you go to the site, you'll see it's a national site. It's backed by a publisher. The site's very attractive, and it's inviting, welcomes people in. We have a product, it's a private label product for cancer centers, advocacy groups, community practices, anybody who's dealing with cancer patients. It'll actually brand that cancer center, so it can invite people. So the way it works with a cancer center, for example, is you would link from the cancer center site. If you go to, for example, roswellpark.org, for any of you who want to check this out, Roswell Park has a community on Cancer Connect. On the homepage of Roswell Park, there's a link to Roswell Park's community on Cancer Connect. Roswell Park's patients can click through that link, and then they come to a welcome page that invites them into the Roswell Park community. Once they sign up, and the registration is very simple, once they sign up, now they can both participate in the Roswell Park conversation at the local level, but they can also participate in the larger national conversation. So for example, if a patient has breast cancer, we have 30 different diseases right now on the site, but so say a patient has breast cancer, they can participate in the conversation, not just with breast cancer patients from Buffalo, which is where Roswell Park Cancer Institute is located, but all around the country, all around the world, actually. For, you know, for English-speaking languages, we're going to be launching a Spanish language version shortly. We're working on that now. But so the business model then is for us to link through many different cancer centers, advocacy groups, physicians' office practices, link the community from their sites.
And what's the aim? I mean, it's so difficult to talk about something like Cancer Connect and without me sounding like an incredibly insensitive, hideous person, which I may be. How is the intention to make money? Is the intention to fund itself? What is the ultimate aim of CancerConnect.com?
Sure, yeah, well, we are a for-profit organization. I come from a not-for-profit background. The publisher, of Omni Health Media is an oncologist. So, I mean, yes, the site has to sustain itself, but we don't have a hurdle rate like a Google or you know, some of these larger organizations. You know, so for a cancer center, I mean, you're talking $20,000 for a cancer center to add this community as a plug-in to their site. It's very inexpensive, and it's a way for them to have the community available to their stakeholders, their patients, caregivers, loved ones. Without having, you know, cancer centers are always, the people at the cancer centers, the administrators, they're always overburdened, overworked. It's a plug-in. So all they have to do is moderate their own community, and then we have moderators for all the different disease areas. So it's very easy for them to plug in. So yes, you know, yes, the site has to be able to sustain itself, but there's no advertising on the site. The licensing model is the revenue.
It's where it comes from. So there's no, my ultimate question is OmniHealth. How do you strike that balance between leading the conversation and being a part of the conversation? Was that you? Not your tummy after lunch. How do you strike that balance between leading the conversation
Sure.
and being a part of that conversation?
We do have other assets. We have a magazine called Women in Cancer Magazine. We repurpose the content from that magazine on the site It's also available for license. So we license content. That's another revenue stream for us. We also build websites for these other cancer centers. So we're a website developer as well. So there are various other revenue streams. But the publisher and I felt very strongly that, I mean, if you look at this evolving community, especially for people with life-threatening diseases, it's really a little frightening about the types of information out there, the misinformation, the quality of information. And we both had a similar vision and passion. And social media, you know, the timing is just right for these conversations to exist. But interestingly, the cancer centers are so delighted with the project because they've tried in various different ways. You know, social media has only been around as a concept, right, since like, what, 2003. So it's new, but they all have support groups, you know, in-person support groups. Social workers at the cancer centers are involved in the community. So part of the way the community is set up is we have different forums for different types of conversations. So for example, one of the groups, Women Against Prostate Cancer at Roswell Park, has a forum within the community on the Roswell Park site. So this is giving more a more extended life to some of their existing programs. So it's kind of a cross between, I mean, it is altruistic. There is a revenue model. As I say, the hurdle rate's not as high as with the larger publisher, you know, as it would be with a larger publisher, but you know, we're doing something that's helpful for patients. They're very grateful. We see some of the posts that just, they're very grateful, and it's very rewarding.
It's social media workers. There you go, push. So Amy, interesting social...
I'm going to use that, Adam.
You're going to
use that, yeah.
Have it. You do some interesting social media marketing principles, which you mentioned earlier, namely embrace the Uber fan. But you decided to seed traffic, forgive me, by sending exclusives on the RuPaul thing to larger sites like Entertainment Week. How do you balance those two on the surface opposing ideas?
Embrace the Uber fan to me is it's providing the Uber fan, the people who are passionate about your project or your product, with enough value on your own. For us, it was, we wanted to provide our Uber fans with enough value, enough assets, enough content, enough sneak peeks, enough exclusive looks that would keep them coming back and keep them friending, keep them liking us now, keep them advocating on our behalf. But at the same time, I need more. You know, so it's not enough that I keep our own happy, I need to acquire a new fan base. So we were very strategic about which content we leaked and which content we kept for ourselves. Our first look of the show, and this was a tough argument to have internally, we leaked to someone else. And our goal behind that was EW has more readers than we can possibly have this first year or the second year of our campaign, of our show. But we believe so strongly in our offering that if you see this, you're going to want more. And the only place you can get more is on our own assets. So harness the power of the Uber fan, to me, all goes hand in hand with the other tenet, which was use the reach of others to expand our message. It goes back to the other people's money. When somebody else could do something for me that I don't have to pay for, I'm going to go with that. So, you know, another example of it to me is we have a partner in Absolute Vodka. Fantastic product. Fantastic vodka.
And other really, vodkas are available.
And a really great marketing partner for us. We use their tools to promote our show. We did a ton of co-branded efforts with Absolute. And we concede some of it with them. We keep enough content on our own site that keeps you coming back for more, and then making sure that there's always a balance. I'm launching a new show now, which is a gay version of The Real Housewives, the A-list New York City. It's really good for you, television. We call it, it's Housewives with Balls, and we're going through it again. We've got this great, great clip. Do we keep it or do we leak it? And I think the one thing that I kept, I heard this morning and I keep listening for, are like the nuggets, the intelligent nuggets about seeding. How are people choosing to seed? Nothing becomes viral. Somebody made it viral. And no, people will argue with that. I do believe it, there's something organic that happens, but usually it's from a smart, strategic, when there's a media company behind it, not the cat videos. Those cat videos become viral, I don't know how. But with the exception of cat videos, there's generally a smart, strategic thought process behind how things are leaked and how you, and how, what your ultimate result of the clip is. So for us, it was leak something that's incendiary, bring it back to us, where we can explain the proposition in better detail. Is that long-winded enough to explain where I was going?
Well, I got it. Everyone else is happy with all that, yeah. In fact, because, of course, by virtue of the majesty of this panel, we have a media agency representative sat next to you. So let's get an answer to that question, Danny, if you don't mind. What is seeding?
Obviously, you know, there's two sides to it all, right? I mean, I think this is kind of where the whole idea between the whole conflict of social media comes into. If you really break down marketing to its bare essentials, right? You have the idea of, you know, kind of building a brand, right? We want to build our brand. We want to build brand equity. We want people to love us for who we are and what we stand for. And then there's the idea of promoting a brand, right? And I think at this kind of inflection point in social media is where, oh my gosh, this is the perfect marketplace where I can not only build my brand, but also promote my brand, but yet they're seemingly conflictual, right? Because I don't want to feel like I want to engage in the conversation. I want to be a part of that conversation. I don't want to sell them anything. But at the same time, I want them to buy something, watch something, do something. I want them to take action. But at the same time, I don't want to force that because by being a good friend and listening and doing all these things we talked about, that's going to help build the brand. And so, I mean, there's no real correct answer for it. I think I go back to the idea that if you have something that's compelling, right, that is, you know, an original thought, that is creative, you know, you have a nugget, then you seed it, right? You get it out there. You tweet it. You talk to the right people. You create the right foundation. And if it's interesting, we're all consumers. We all do this. If it's interesting, we share it. And it doesn't mean you're sharing it necessarily with everyone in your entire company. Maybe you share it with your 10 closest friends, right? You mean, hey, check this out. This is great. You're going to love this. And it starts quite slowly. But if there's a nice, if it's compelling, if it's creative, if there's something that you think that is worth sharing, it grows. I think your show, I think that's like that will be intriguing. It's creative. There's something witty about it. So I think the secret to seeding anything is have something that's worth sharing. You know, may have something that's worth, you know, engaging in a conversation that's going to be of interest to, you know, the people around you. It kind of goes back to the idea of creativity, right? You know, it doesn't necessarily mean something funny or witty or, you know, or comical or without thought or just satire. Much the opposite. It means that it drives emotion, that it connects, you know, with us all on an emotional level. And I think that is, the power and the excitement of this industry is that, at the end of the day, what we're talking about is connecting with people on some level. You know, that the videos we watched about Kodak, I mean, everyone got a little, well, I don't know about you, I got a little misty, kind of an easy sell that way. But, you know, here's a 10-second video, and all of a sudden I feel myself, you know, welling up a little bit. And I think that's like, wow, how powerful, you know, to connect with the brand at the same time, you know, I guess engage in conversation. So, anyway, I'm rambling a little bit, and I apologize. But seeding goes back. Is your idea worth sharing? You know, am I going to be a better person for sharing that out to my fan base, out to my friends, my colleagues, or am I going to get the, hey, you know, take me off your email list, Dan? Which is a valid question.
Does that make sense? Kind of answer you, Amy? Is that the nitty-gritty to which you wanted to?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's not, I think there are exceptions. There's lightning in a bottle. There's the time where you know that this person was not creating this video with the intent of it becoming, and it became a phenomenon. Nobody makes a phenomenon, but I do think you can make a hit. And I think that what I strive for, whenever, you know, my boss constantly says, well, why isn't this viral? And I feel like I need to defend, I will never be able to make something truly a viral phenomenon, but I can make it a hit. And if I go in knowing what my goals for a hit are, they're really quite modest comparatively. I don't need 20 million views for RuPaul's Drag Race. I don't need 20 million viewers for RuPaul's Drag Race to be a hit. I don't need, like you were saying, I don't need to be, but I do need 200,000, yeah. You know? So if I, and that's obtainable to me. When my boss says make something viral, and we have the discussion of what do you want that to look like, then I can better manage expectations and better plot my seeding. And that would require, do we outsource to a PR firm? Can we handle this internally? Do we go to our blogosphere of people who we know can advocate on our behalf? I mean, it kind of, once we define the parameters of what we need to do to be successful, it becomes a lot easier to make something hit virally. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Did it make sense? We're nodding. There was nodding. Yeah, it made sense. So, Andy, I'd like to come back to you if I can do. You mentioned stories starting in the main paper and then proliferating online. This goes to one of the core issues or internal objections around social, which is we don't have the staff for it. And again, you addressed, I mean, very specifically, 500 journalists, only 10% that work on social media. We know what the challenge is. Have you found any solutions? Are there any workarounds there?
No. So no one who's a journalist works their way up from the Columbus, Ohio newspaper to the St. Louis newspaper to the Los Angeles Times to write about a school board issue. Nobody writes their entire career, gets to one of the greatest news organizations in the country, and doesn't want to do the grand scale international story. They all want to go to Turkey when there's a conflict in Turkey. They all want to go to the Middle East. And so the challenge is, how do we create excitement around local engagement where our page view growth is? So again, 50% of our page view growth is around local. And local is inherently not sexy to most journalists that work at the Los Angeles Times. We've made a couple of mistakes. One is on the business side of things. We hired the social media manager for Britney Spears to run our social media policy. We hired her on the business side of things, not on the editorial side. As a result, we've built another wall of distrust between the business side and the editorial side, and there's no sense of ownership on the editorial side that they need to own social in the same way that they own their stories. So they inherently understand ESPN as a great vehicle for them to talk to their readers. They don't understand social in the same way.
Absolutely, yeah. Clearly, a very large thing. We'll get back to that in a moment. So Daniel, you said yesterday that the barriers to entry for social media are practically zero, but that doesn't take away from people liking to see something done well. Not necessarily big budget, but well executed. I'm just wondering if there's any kind of advice or anything you would like to share with particular reference to kind of, you know, Andy's very difficult situation there. Clearly he has the people who are capable of delivering the idea that you want, this incredibly well-executed vision, but can't get people involved. And I'm assuming, guessing, that perhaps that's something that affects a fair few of you here in terms of getting staff involved in social media engagement.
Wow. Hey, Andy, I don't know if I have the answer for you. I do believe in this idea, you know, what we're talking about, and I think there's kind of a common theme is about innovation, right? Like everything we're doing as a marketplace, as a company, as a country, as kind of this next phase of our revolution or evolution as an industry, it's about innovation. And I think it's a challenge for all of us in the sense that we all have to create environments where, you know, let me step back. A fundamental belief that we have is that we believe everyone gets up in the morning and wants to come to work and do a good job. They want to be inspired, they want to be empowered. And we throw these terms around quite easily, right? Oh, you need to empower people to take charge and, you know, to throw it out there, to take a risk and, you know, to take ownership for their actions. But if you really think about this, you know, that's a hell of an operational challenge, having everyone come into your office every day and be empowered, be inspired to take those things on. And I think where I'm going with this is, in order to really do this, if you really want people to take ownership for their actions and then be empowered, then you need to create the environment for them to innovate. It's an environment of safety, it's an environment of trust, it's an environment where anyone can say anything, and communication happens freely across all levels. You know, there's no vertical communication structure, it's very flat. And, you know, it's about getting people the opportunity to be a part of the team. I think too often, a lot of organizations struggle with the fact that, like, yes, you're a part of the team, but you're really not a part of the team. You know, there's a structure that doesn't allow empowerment. And if you really want people to start tweeting on behalf of your organization, no matter what it is, or about, you know, or to be coming up with, you know, innovative solutions for the organization, then I think, you know, we as organizations need to take a hard look about the types of environments that we are creating. Because it's, you know, the old models of, you know, hey, you know, CEO, it's almost a marketing model. CEO says something and everyone else does it. Just like in the marketing world, like that doesn't work anymore, right? You really want to be effective in an organization as well as in a marketing standpoint. You know, it's a collaboration. That's the word, you know, that's been. Everyone is engaged. They're collaborating. And that starts with trust. It starts with breaking down barriers of consequence. It supports failure. I mean, everything we're talking about today, it's like, oh my gosh, what if we fail? And once again, back to Jeff, hey, we're not going to kill anybody. Like, no one died. Like, it's a very valid point to everything. It's like, take the risk. But if someone does empower it and throw something out there, and it does go wrong, like our reaction, how we react as a community, as companies, as marketers, is critical. I mean, watch that next step carefully. So I'm not sure if that answered your question, Andy, but empowerment is not a memo that changes. I mean, I think we need to fundamentally look at ourselves as a culture, you know, how we run our businesses as a company culture.
Yeah.
Agree? Anyway.
Oh, that was very good. Thank you very much indeed. That was a particular curveball for me as well. So, Alana, if I ask you one thing, Michael Donnelly, who's a group director of interactive marketing at Coca-Cola, said once, and I thought this was quite nice, we was talking about moderators on the Coca-Cola kind of message boards and all that sort of thing. And he said, we no longer call them moderators, we call them curators. Because their job, in fact, is to find the nuggets and to make sure that those nuggets rise to the top. We were asking him about how do you avoid, you know, people just kind of posting on Coca-Cola, oh, it rots your teeth, or da-da-da. And he said, well, we have these curators, not these moderators. Quite a nice sort of sense of things, I thought. Something you talk about your chat forum and everything being, forgive me if I've used the wrong terminology, but being moderated. Again, how do you maintain trust without, because curation does, there is a kind of slight, there's an editorial policy there, which isn't perhaps in line with social media.
Well, I love that word, curators, and I might borrow that one too, so, because that's really what our moderators are. They're our caretakers, which when I think of curator, that's what I think are our caretakers. So the way our policy works is if you're new to Cancer Connect, when you come in, you select a primary disease that you have interest in. You're automatically a member of that community because we have many different communities on the site. You're welcomed by the moderator. That's the first thing that happens is you get a message within the community. Welcome to Cancer Connect, I'm the moderator. Everybody uses screen names, pseudonyms, I'm the moderator. I'd like to welcome you. Let me know if you have anything specific on your mind. Are there certain conversations that you're looking to participate in? And then the job of the moderator is to, you know, listen. That's another one of our themes, listening to the response of the new member and then connect them with either another member that they're aware of, because our moderators, as part of our training, they're not just responsible for reading the posts in their community, but they're also encouraged to read the posts throughout. We have 35 communities, 30 of which are disease specific, but then there's 5 communities right now that are areas that cross over diseases. Insurance issues is probably the most popular of the communities. But there's lots of conversations that take place. So the moderator will invite the new member in to participate in those conversations. And this way we try to keep conversations so that there aren't duplicate conversations taking place in different parts of the community. Our moderators try to bring people together and really pay attention to what the concerns are of our members. And I mean, I think that that's really where trust, you know, where trust is really reinforced, because the members, it's not like you just go into a community and you post something and you never hear from anybody. You're always going to hear from somebody. You're going to be encouraged to participate in a community where we know that there's a similar interest that you have, that you've expressed, and we're going to try to connect you with someone who is also sharing those concerns.
Thank you very much indeed. Right. We'll cast our net far and wide now. Shall we just have a little look out into the audience? Does anybody out there have a question that they would like to ask anybody about anything what we have covered so far? Wow. It's yes, madam.
Logistically, how did you start listening, like a business? You're just getting into the space. What were your first steps to listen, and how does that growth evolve?
Anybody in particular, or is it first come, first serve? First come, first serve. Anyone want to take that one?
Well, I mean, the first thing that we did was we defined a role, and we hired a social media manager, and her job was essentially, okay, organize all the different editorial Twitter feeds into categories. So we've got now got 47 different categories, and she is responsible for making sure that someone on the consumer relations side within the editorial staff or the actual journalist that wrote the story does some sort of interaction with that community. Similarly, she developed a set of rules around Facebook as well. So that was like our first step, was to make sure that there was at least that linchpin role so that we could make sure that the responses were funneling through in some logical fashion.
Uh-huh. Anybody else like to take that? Amy, when did you first start this? Oh, Alana,
sure.
Thank you.
For us, you know, we did quite a bit of due diligence. Just about a year ago, we finished the business plan for this community, and we looked at a lot of other communities and what people were talking about, and there were quite a few gaps. I mean, there's a lot of good information. There's some really great sites out there that provide, you know, like the area of breast cancer. It's very, very well received. Lots of information, lots of places for people to go to talk. But beyond that, it falls off quite quickly. So cancer is over 200 different diseases, and what we wanted to do is create a robust format where people with, you know, any issue with respect to cancer could come, could get great content, and also be able to connect with other people. So when you talk about listening, I mean, we went into these other communities, looked, listened to the conversations. That's quite honestly why we decided to put a moderator forum in. It's more labor intensive to have a moderator, but there are many sites now that people can post. It's an open chat room, and anybody can post anything, and no one ever responds in some cases. So, you know, that was actually a very important element for us.
Okay. And I'd just like to ask one more question, if I can. And it's a kind of candor and honesty question, if you don't mind. I have a 12-year-old son. My son is lovely, really, really nice, absolutely zero road sense. The road sense of a bewildered puppy. He is 12, no idea. So the other day, I showed him a video on YouTube of this guy dancing out into the road. I don't know if anybody's seen it. He's with his friend. He's kind of dancing out into the road like that, going da-da-da-da-da, showing off. And a car comes by and goes bang and just knocks him down. And I thought, it's very rarely that you actually get a video you can show somebody, especially somebody you care about as deeply as I care about my son, and say, look. Because all the time you're telling him, don't do that because X will happen. I can actually show him what will happen. Do you know what? It worked. It was absolutely brilliant. He's terrified of roads. But other than that, he won't leave the house. It's gone really well. So Mary talked last night about the failure with Dr. Laundry and what they learned from that. And I think Jeff stood up earlier and talked about his movie theater text, kind of fail. The question, I suppose, then, is inevitable. It's the sort of end of the conference. I'd just like to ask you, mistakes that you've made that you can be honest about and lessons that you've learned. Is there anything that you can tell these good people here, I did this so you don't have to?
I would say if you could have a crystal ball and make it nice and clear, because when we envisioned this project a year ago, clearly the market was in a different place and the economy was in a different place. And so as a startup, it's been much more challenging. So I guess just making sure, you know, like with anything, that your funding is solid, that you're flexible in your business plan. I mean, it's very interesting where we thought the revenue was going to come from to sustain the site. That model has changed completely, radically different. It's still good, but it's very different. So I would say flexibility is really important.
Andy?
I think I've heard it over and over again here today, and it's a mistake that we made. We did not define upfront what our social media strategy was and communicate it across the organization. Therefore, we've got a huge disconnect between the business side of our operations and our editorial side, resulting in very little employee involvement with social media. So I think what I've heard from a lot of people and what I've learned here is that developing that strategy up front and communicating it clearly through your organization so that people feel empowered and involved in that's key.
Absolutely. Thank you much indeed.
Can't go back.
Yeah. Hot tub time machine. Daniel?
I think this, I hope this doesn't sound too high level, but I really do believe it's about you know, preparing for failure, right? I mean, marketing and really business in general, it's kind of based off of the premise of scientific method, right? Trial and error. And I think this new era that we're upon is a lot of trial and a whole lot of error. But, you know, we shouldn't, I hope the idea, I think what everyone needs to be comfortable with, is like, don't be frustrated with your errors. Don't think like it was a failure. I mean, look for the successful points of it, right? And ask yourself, you know, how do we then improve upon it? I mean, I thought Mary's point yesterday was, it was actually quite inspiring, you know? I mean, her product line, a lot of people would be like, oh my gosh, how do you take Clorox, the brand of Clorox, out into the social sphere? And, you know, tip of the hat, she gave it a shot. She ran at it, like they just tried it, you know? And hey, it didn't work, or it, you know, they had some challenges, they set back, but now they are that much smarter for it. And so I think the idea that, look, you're gonna fail, like that's just what's gonna happen. You're going to fail. Look for the gleaming points of like success in it. Ask yourself difficult questions, not what we liked about it, but really what didn't we like about it, and build upon that. You really want to build a strong marketing strategy, social marketing strategy. Get used to the idea you're going to fail, and that you're going to be in this for a long time. You're going to engage in this conversation, that is in this process that will evolve. You will grow, your campaign will grow, your company will grow over this. But it will only grow from your failures, and you'll learn a bit from your success. But the next time you do it, it'll be different. So get used to it. Failure, it works.
Thank you much, Steve. Amy?
You've made no mistakes. Just kidding. I've made a lot of mistakes. I think the two things, Patrick Lencioni in one of his books, and I never quote books that are business oriented, but this one really stuck with me was, you know, I'm gonna destroy the quote, so I'll give you the concept. The concept was, and the nature of marketing is you make decisions without all the information. And a good marketer will course correct once they get more information. I have so many examples where the idea that I thought was really great, I can give one particular example. We have the application, I'm sure you're all familiar with it, the Dragulator application, where you yourself can turn yourself into a drag queen with 5 easy clicks. Loved the idea, and we had this idea that the drag queens were all going to provide real-time critiques to the various people who are uploading their images and providing them with pointers of how they can make themselves a better drag queen. I don't know why we thought this was so genius, but we went into this whole hog. Like, this is going to be the best drag queen transformations. We realized that people, A, don't care that much about having their critiques, having their drag queen personas critiqued by a real live drag queen, and drag queens are impossible to motivate to get to do anything. So we spent money, we spent effort, we advertised it, we put it on TV, we did outreach. You know, we did have several hundred people uploading their photos. We had one drag queen who commented on all of them. It was pretty much a colossal failure, but the idea was really good, nobody died. And we learned the valuable lesson of never trust a drag queen to comment on social media. Which, in case you guys need to take something away, that should
it's
be the nugget.
Worthwhile.
You might want to just end the conversation.
Well, do you know what, bizarrely? So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. That's the big takeaway from my strategy. Thanks for coming for 2 days. Don't trust your social media strategy to drag queens. And I hope you enjoyed it. No, before we go, thank you very much, Steve, for that. We are just going to take a little quick public vote, if you don't mind, if everybody's up for that. And what I'd like to find out from you is kind of the top, say, 4 or 5 things that you have taken away or will take away from iStrategy. Just one thing, if somebody can tell me one thing. And then our panel get to provide the kind of casting vote in a sort of American Idol type of way. Because we're mixing all sorts of media here. This is on the fly, it's incredible stuff. So does anybody have one lesson, one thing that they've taken away from iStrategy that they can share? Yes?
One thing is that we can't be silent. We have to be able to do things across departments and be able to do collaboration.
To collaboration, the importance of collaboration and not being forced into our silos. So if everybody now, you have to kind of have to keep a little count. Put your hands up if you think that would be your number one learning, collaboration. Hands in the air now. Well, there was one for you. I enjoyed that one. Chris, you have one.
Yeah, I think people's toes have gone beyond getting their toes wet, but that they're still fearing failure more than seizing and looking for the opportunity.
Right, okay, so fear of failure. People still having a fear of failure. I tell you what we'll do, we'll go through all of them, and then we'll vote on one, because that way we don't expose people so cruelly as we just did. Yes? Absolutely, which is what sort of Amy was talking about earlier with what she needed to be a hit to get a hit hit there. Fantastic, thank you much indeed. So quality over quantity, collaboration, and fear of failure. Yes, sir. Yeah, of course, don't worry.
I think one of the
tenets
of the collaborative idea that you need to listen to the customer. And for me, walking away, like social media is another voice of the customer. You can't ignore it.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, see, that's a really nice one, actually. Yeah, kind of that social media, you know, almost, of course, that kills the conference. Thanks. You know, because if it's not separate, then that's ruined that. But other than the fact that you've just killed everything, no, brilliant, really enjoy it. And one more. Has anybody got anything else that they'd like to take away or have learned from iStrategy? Yes, sir.
There will be
muffins. Thank you very much. We can label that one, I think, with the drag queen type of stuff. So now what I'm going to ask you to do is to put your hands up for the one that you think is the most applicable, the one kind of key learning that we can take away here. So the first one was collaboration. Everybody, hands in the air for, now we know them all, collaboration. Who thinks that collaboration is one of their key lessons? You change your mind. Good, like it. Thinking. So who thinks that fear of failure, removing the fear of failure is key? Thank you very much indeed. You voting for it yourself, Chris?
Yes, embracing yeah. risk.
Embracing risk, embracing risk. Okay, absolutely. The fact that we should no longer silo social media, that it needs to be very much a part of the whole kind of customer listening focus. Who'd like to vote for that one?
Can we vote for more than
two
one?
There. Can you vote for more than one?
No.
Just keep it harsh. And the, it was brilliant. Which was quality over the absolute, so I did, really, forgive me, to apologize. Quality over quantity. Who says that one there is one of the key things? Absolutely lovely. Thank you very much. You did vote twice, cheeky. So panel. What's our winner? What's our number one takeaway from iStrategy?
Look like embrace risk to me.
Yeah.
Embrace risk. Mr. Huer, spot on again. Thank you very much indeed, everybody. Please, a big round of applause for the panel. That, ladies and gentlemen, is it for this event for iStrategy 2010 in Chicago. I'd just like to thank the iStrategy team for all of their hard and exemplary organizational work. So a round of applause for them, please. I think they did really, really well. Thank you. Fora.tv, do remember that you can, all of this stuff is available for purchase from Fora.tv, f.o.r.a.tv, and that's Stuart and Bob at the back there who've been doing that, and Perry, so round of applause for them, think they've been absolutely fantastic. And David at the back on the left there, who has sat there perfectly throughout the whole 2 days, making sure that everybody can hear everything everybody says, so thank you, David, fantastic stuff. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you've learned a lot. There is another event in San Jose. I believe you can see any of the staff members for details. I'm not going to hit you up with any kind of hard sell. And if you can fill out your feedback forms, because that's the way we can make this better. You all understand the value of feedback. That's what you do. It would be really good to hear. And there are farewell drinks in the Encore bar. Once more for the Encore. So there are farewell drinks there.